Today we are starting with the chapter of minor oral surgical procedures, in which you must know about the detail of principles of oral surgery. So you must know about all the principles of oral surgery. We have almost 14 principles. So starting in the intro portion, which is basic purpose of surgery. So purpose of surgery is elimination of disease, prevention of disease, removal of damage or redundant tissue, improvement of function and aesthetics. So this is the thing which you must know is the principle of oral surgeries. One, which is developing a surgical diagnosis. Second, which is the basic necessities for surgery. Third, which is aseptic technique. Fourth is incision planning. Fifth is flap design. Sixth is tissue handling. Seventh is hemostasis. Eighth is dead space management. Then we have decontamination and debridement, suturing, edema control, post-operative infection control, patient general health and nutrition, follow-up. So we'll be going in detail of all these 14 principles. So starting with the first, which is developing a surgical diagnosis. So to develop a diagnosis, our routine procedure is history taking, then we do clinical examination, radiological examination, laboratory investigations, and then we interpret the final diagnosis. So this is the thing which you have done in clinical postings of your oral medicine and radiology department. So I'll be going fastly through this step, which is history taking, in which you take biographic data, chief complaints, HOPI, medical history, past dental history, family history. In clinical examination, you take general examination, extraoral, intraoral examination. So starting with history taking. So history taking is defined as a planned professional conversation that enables patient to communicate his her symptoms, feelings, fears to the clinician so as to obtain an insight into the nature of patient illness and his her attitude to them. So in general, a case history is nothing but an evaluation of patient prior to the dental treatment. A case history is of immense value in the following ways: to establish the diagnosis, to detect any medical problem, evaluating a systemic problems, discovering the communicable diseases, management of emergencies, for effective treatment planning. So chief complaint is established by asking the patient to describe the problem for which he or she has came to seek the help or treatment, right? So it is recorded in his own words as much as possible. It is recorded in chronological order, and it will aid in the diagnosis and treatment planning and should be given the first priority. So what all chief complaints can be? It can be pain, burning sensations, bleeding, loose teeth, recent occlusal problems, delayed tooth eruptions, xerostomia, swelling, bad taste, paresthesia, anesthesias, bad breath. So then we have HOPI. HOPI is basically, initially patient may not volunteer the detailed history of the problem. So the examiner has to elicit out the additional information by the possible questionnaire about the symptoms. So what we ask, examiner is asking that, when did the problem start? What did you notice the first? Did you have any problem or symptoms related to this? What makes the problem worsen or better? Do you have undergone any tests been performed before the diagnosis of this complaint? Have you consulted any other examiner for this problem? And what have you done to treat this problem, and etc. So in general, symptoms can be elaborated as under the mode of onset, cause of onset, duration, progress and referred pain, relapse and remission, treatment and negative history. So after that, we have detailed history of particular symptoms like pain. We have location, origin and mode of onset, intensity of pain, nature of pain, progression of pain, duration of pain, movement of pain, localization behavior, neurological signs, temporal behavior. Then we have swelling, swelling location, duration, mode of onset, symptom, progress of swelling, associated features, secondary changes in the swelling, impairment of function, recurrence of swelling, ulcer, mode of onset of ulcer, duration of ulcer, associated pain, discharge, and any associated disease. Then we finally come on to the clinical examination, in which we check general, extraoral, intraoral. In general, we check the build, gait, nourishment, consciousness. If there is head injury or facial trauma or accident, then we check this Glasgow Coma Scale. Then we have a pulse, a BP, respiratory rate, cyanosis, pallor, and all that. So in pulse, we have rate, rhythm, volume of pulse, tense and force and character of pulse. So you in pulse you check all these things, then you have to check the blood pressure, then you will check body temperature, respiratory rate, cyanosis, clubbing, icterus, jaundice, etc. When coming to extraoral examination, you check the skin, in which you check the appearance of skin, color of skin, texture, signs, pigmentation of the skin, edema of the skin, you check the facial asymmetry, then you check the temporomandibular joint, you check temporomandibular joint for derangement of joint, any symmetry of the joint, you check the interincisal opening, deviations, vertical movement, range of lateral movements, you check for clicking, crepitus sounds, you check tenderness over masticatory muscle or joint area, then you palpate the joint area. So all of these things comes under the clinical posting of your oral medicine and radiology department. There you learn about all these things, how you palpate the joint area, how you palpate the pretragus area, intra-auricular depression, then you how you palpate the lymph nodes, how then we have eye, nose. In eye you check for anemia, jaundice, infection of maxillary teeth extend to orbital region, causes swelling in the eyelid and conjunctivitis. For nose you check the size of nose, deviated nasal septum, or something like saddle nose, which is seen in congenital syphilis. Salivary glands, in which you check the parotid gland, you palpate the parotid gland and submandibular gland. Parotid gland palpation known as bidigital palpation, and submandibular gland palpation is known as bimanual palpation. Then you check for intraoral examination. In intraoral you have to check soft tissues like tongue, you have to check the volume of tongue, integrity of the papillae, any cracks or fissure in the tongue, swelling or ulcers on the tongue, mobility of the tongue. You check the palate. For palate you check clefts, perforations, ulcerations, swelling, burns, hyperkeratinization, fistula, tori, papillary hyperplasia. So all these things you check in the palate. In lips, what you will check? First of all you check the competency, lip color, texture, surface abnormalities, cleft lip, pigmentation over the lip, and you check the neoplasms or chancre, and you check the diffuse enlargement of the lips. Then you check floor of mouth. How you check floor of mouth? You ask the patient touch the tongue upwards to touch the palate. You have to place the tongue to touch the palate so that your floor of mouth is visible and exposed. Then you check color, swelling, any presence of any patches, and ankyloglossia. After that you check the buccal mucosa, any ulceration, pigmentation or any other things. Then you finally come on to the hard tissue examination, in which you check the teeth, number of teeth present, missing teeth, filled teeth, decayed teeth, any defective, fractured, restoration, attrition, erosion, abrasion, root stumps, fluorosis, any congenital deformities. And finally we come on over to the investigation section, in which we have radiological examination. In radiological we have conventional and a specialized radiography. Conventional radiography means all the conventional methods which you do in your routine practice. So 2D dimensional projection image of a 3D object, in which we have intraoral radiographic methods, extraoral methods. And in specialized we have CT, which is computed tomography, ultrasonography, MRI, which is magnetic resonance imaging, radionucleotide imaging, xylography, arthrography, angiography, and CBCT. So this whole thing which we done, the first principle was the developing a surgical diagnosis. We have yet developed a surgical diagnosis. This was the first principle of oral surgery. Now you will say that what was the need of writing a huge case history, right? But it is important. I will tell you the importance of case history. Some diseases adversely affected by the dental treatment, like cardiovascular diseases, diseases of blood, which includes hemophilia, cirrhosis, leukemia, patient on anticoagulant therapy, epileptic patients with epilepsy, patients with immunodeficiency state, renal diseases, right? And some diseases may compromise the response of body tissues to the surgical procedures. Example, in diabetes mellitus, anemia, leukemia, cancer, patient on radiotherapy, patient on immunosuppressor drug, right? And some disease will render the patient less tolerant to the standard dental procedure, right? It can be acute anxiety, COPD, asthma, chronic bronchitis, silicosis, patients who are taking antihypertensive drugs, patients who are taking immunosuppressive drugs, or mentally retarded patients. And some diseases can be transmitted from patient to another or from patient to us. So they can be communicable diseases, right? chronically patients who are in chronically infected by such diseases like hepatitis, HIV, tuberculosis, upper respiratory tract infection. So this is all the importance of taking a case history, a good case history, right? Second principle of oral surgery is basically basic necessities for surgery. So what will require for a surgery? So we have three basic requirements for surgery. First of all is adequate visibility, right? Adequate visibility. Then we have equipment, and third we have assistant. So first is adequate visibility, adequate access. We require adequate access, and we require comfortable patient. So patient should be comfortable mentally and physically also. Patient should does not have any fear in the mind, right? Proper retraction of tissue. So your assistant should retract the tissue properly. High volume sections are used to increase the visibility and for bloodless field. Then we have adequate light source. Of course, light source should be adequate. Surgical field should be clean, free from excessive bleeding. Then you have equipment. So what will be the equipment requirement for a surgery? Your equipment, you should have all the instrument kit prepared and sterilized, right? Then you have assistant. In assistant, when you add assistant, it becomes a four-handed surgery or a four-handed dentistry. And your assistant must be skilled, and he should be familiar with the procedure being performed. Okay, then we have aseptic techniques. So aseptic techniques is the third principle of surgery. Third principle of oral surgery is aseptic technique, and it is a fundamental essential principle of infection control in the clinical and surgical settings. And basically aseptic techniques come under the chapter of sterilization chapter, right? It comes under the sterilization. So we'll be doing in detail when we're doing the sterilization chapter. So I will going very fast through this sterilization aseptic techniques chapter, aseptic techniques topic, right? So it includes removal or reducing or killing the microorganisms from the hands or the objects, and employing the sterile instruments and other items. Then we have aseptic techniques before or during a surgical procedure to reduce the post of infections. So maintaining a sterile field, surgical attire, hand washing, surgical scrub, sterile gowning and gloving, patient surgical skin preparation. So we prepare the patient's skin where we have to do the surgery using surgical barriers like sterile surgical drapes, using safe operative techniques, and maintaining a safe environment. So all these things comes in aseptic procedures. And we will be doing in detail of all these things like scrub sequence, scrub attire, then cap, mask, then hand scrub, then you surgical gown, then glove, and what all hand scrub you do. All the solutions like povidine, iodine, chlorhexidine, triclosan, alcohol, scrub preparation like pump pack, disposable brush, scrub station, before scrubbing, scrub methods. So all we'll be doing these things in your sterilization chapter. So fourth principle is planning for incision. Now this is important principle, and you have to write in detail about how you do the incisions, how you plan for incisions, right? Planning an incision. So incision, first of all, definition. What is definition of incision? A cut or a wound deliberately made by an operator in the skin or mucosa using a sharp instrument such as surgical blade or cautery, etc., so that underlying structure can be exposed adequately for surgical access. So that underlying structure can be exposed adequately for surgical access. These are all the principles of incision, right? Principles for incision. This is the main heading or main short note which can be asked, like principles for incisions. So principles for incision is, first of all, parallel to the structures without damaging the vital structure. So it should be parallel to the blood vessels, parallel to vital structure, and should not damage the vital structures. Number two, along the Langer's line, so that scar formation is minimum. Then you have to use a sharp blade, use of a sharp blade of proper size, right? Then you have firm continuous stroke. So what is in the firm continuous stroke? Basically, you do not repeat the strokes. Repeated strokes increase both the amount of tissue damage and the bleeding, and therefore they decrease the wound healing. That's why a long continuous stroke is required and is preferred over short interrupted ones. right? Skin or the mucosa to be incised should be stabilized with finger pressure. You stabilize the skin or you stabilize the mucosa which has to be incised by your finger pressure. Then we have incise perpendicular to the epithelial surface, right? You have to keep your blade perpendicular over the epithelium. Then what we have, incision is placed on sound bone away from the surgical area to prevent the dehiscence. When I will be talking complications of flap surgery, then I will tell about the dehiscence. What is dehiscence? So place the incision on the sound bone, never on the surgical area, right? Away from the surgical area. Then we have pen grasp. So either you use the pen grasp in intraoral incisions, or you use a table knife grasp for extraoral incision. But for now, you must know that as a basic, you must know that you have to hold your BP handle with a pen grasp, right? Pen grasp with proper support and pressure to produce a atraumatic and clean incision with predictable depth. Then you have, there should be no sharp angles, right? No sharp angles, because if you want to change the direction of incision, then you accomplish it by a gradual curve. You take gradual curve, right? But no sharp incision, because sharp angles tend to produce slough due to poor circulation and may lead to extensive scarring, right? Then for better aesthetic results, following basic concepts can be used. Like if you are using incisions, you can hide the incisions in the orifice, like you hide it in the oral cavity, or you hide it in the nasal cavity, you hide it in the hair bearing areas, and hair lines provide the coverage. Then you can put your incision on junction of aesthetic units, like vermilion border or around the aloft nose. Or you can put your incisions on normal wrinkles, right, or skin creases. There it will lead to a better aesthetic result. Now I will tell you contraindication for placement of incision line, where you do not have to put any incision. First of all, and the important contraindication is canine prominence. Over canine prominence, never place any incision. So it will create a soft tissue defect, like bony fenestrations, right? Then you have vertical incision in the mental nerve region. You never ever place any vertical incision in a mental nerve region, right? You do not place any vertical incision over the palate, near GP vessels, right? Near greater palatine, posteriorly, and near incisive papilla or through the incisive papilla, you do not have to place your incision. Then you have over bony lesions, right? Torus, over torus, you do not have to give the incision, otherwise they will create wound dehiscence, right? Wound will edges will split apart. Then we have over frenum. You do not place incision over frenum, and vertical incision should be never placed on the lingual side of mandibular arch. On the lingual side of mandibular arch, you never place vertical incisions. Then we come to the types of incisions. So types of incisions, like horizontal incisions. Horizontal incisions are along the gingival margin, either mesially or distally. It can be of internal bevel incision, it can be a clavicular incision. Generally, we say internal bevel is a first incision and clavicular incision is a second incision, right? Then we have vertical incision. It is also known as releasing incision. So when you have a single vertical incision, it will result into a triangular flap. When you have double vertical incisions, then it will result into a trapezoidal flap. So all this you will know in detail when we will doing the flaps, triangular flaps and the trapezoidal flap. Then you will get to know what is single vertical and what is double vertical incision. Okay, so vertical incision is always extended beyond mucogingival line, right? Beyond mucogingival line, over the alveolar mucosa, so that you adequately reflect your flap, right? So for adequate release of your flap for reflection. Then your third, which is your semilunar incision, it can be curved or it can be elliptical incision. So this finishes the planning of an incision. So I hope this video is a little bit long, so I will put all other principles in a separate video. In the next video, we will be starting from the flap design. So I suppose this lecture will be beneficial to you. Thank you all.